Hello, Pythoneer. In this video, I show you four ways to validate an email address in Python. We start with the simplest and most lightweight method and progress to a more advanced, production-ready approach. Whether you want to perform a quick basic validation or a more robust check, this video has you covered. Let's not waste any time and get straight into it. We start with the simplest version that just checks if the email address contains an @ and a dot. For this, we use Python's built-in parsaddr function from the email utils library, which we need to import. Then we create an isValid email function with an email we provide as input. As output, we will get a Boolean back. We will reuse this function for all four methods. Then we use a try-accept block to catch possible errors. Inside this, we simply pass the email to the parsaddr function, take the second element from the returned tuple, which is the extracted email address, and assign it to a variable. Then we return the Boolean result of checking if there is an @ and a dot inside this variable. We add an exception that returns false if called, indicating that if there is an error, we return false. To check this function, I created a small list of example emails. Then we use these values to loop over and pass them to the isValid email function and print the result to the terminal, where we simply say, if we get back true, it's valid. If not, it's invalid. When we run this, we see that this check got most right. But in the last example, our check failed, and this edge case was not caught because the double dots are not valid in an email. If you don't want or are not allowed to import a library, then the next method might be for you. Here, we just use string methods to perform a very restrictive email validation. Given the same base function and examples to run the code, we can first use the count function for the @ on the past email. If we don't get back a 1, the email doesn't contain or contains more than 1 @. Or if there is no dot in the email, we directly end this and return false. If we pass this check, we can do deeper validation. Here, we are interested in the indexes in the email where the @ is and the last dot as preparation for further list slicing. To grab the @ index, we use the index function for the @ on the email and store this in a variable and the last dot index by using the rindex or reverse index function using the dot as input. With this information, we can already run a simple check. If the last dot is in front of the @, there is no domain after the @, and the validation fails, and we return false. When we pass this check, we can go even deeper. Here, we use list slicing to get first the local part, that is the email part until the @, the domain part, which is the part after the @ until the last dot, and the TLD, or top-level domain, which is the last dot index plus 1 until the end of the string, and store all of them in variables. We can use these three variables to perform multiple checks. First, we check if all three variables contain content. If not, it's not an email, and we return false. Second, we check if the email's local and domain parts are alphanumeric, and if the top-level domain is alphabetic and at least 2 characters long. If any condition fails, the email is invalid, and we return false. Otherwise, we return true. The last check has some room for improvement, but it's getting more and more complex. When we run this, we see it's usable for a basic, simple email, but when we get more complex emails that should be valid, it already fails, as we see with my email address that is real. Before we move on to example 3, if you've watched until here and you like it so far, please consider giving it a like and subscribe. Okay, let's continue. The next version uses a regular expression to check if an email address is valid or not by comparing it to an email pattern. If you're scared about regex, please don't run away. I promise you it's not that difficult. This is way more flexible and advanced compared to the two methods before. To use it, we first have to import Python's built-in RE module. Then we can use the same function as before. Here, we use this single line to perform a more advanced email validation. We use the compile function from the RE module and pass the email regex pattern that we want the past email to match against. This compiles the regular expression pattern into a regex object, which can be used for matching operations. We store this in a new variable. Now let me explain the pattern to you. The R initializes the regex pattern. The quotes enclose the string. The caret indicates the start of the string. The local part of the email is represented by allowed characters. This includes lowercase a to z, uppercase a to z, 0 to 9, underscore, dot, plus, and minus. Next, we check for the @ symbol. After that, we define the domain name characters. A literal dot follows, representing the separator. Finally, the domain extension characters are specified, ending with the $ to mark the end of the string. We now use this compiled pattern to check it against the past email address using the match function and return the Boolean we get back from this. When we run this, we see we are already getting a more precise email validation, but still missing the last example. To make this even more bulletproof, we can use the last method, which utilizes the independent open source email validator package. This package not only checks for correct syntax, but also verifies if the domain is configured to receive emails, enhancing deliverability assurance. It supports internationalized domain names and provides user-friendly error messages, making it suitable for applications like user registration forms. Its comprehensive validation capabilities surpass basic regular expression checks, ensuring more reliable and accurate email validation. Since it's a third-party library, we need to install it using the command pip install email validator. Then, we extend the input to the valid email function. We first define a return details variable with a default value of false. By default, the library returns multiple pieces of information about the email passed to it. Since I just want to get back a Boolean, I disable it here by setting it to false. But I want to show you how you could access the information, which is why I included it here. The second part is the check deliverability parameter set to true, which performs DNS, domain name system queries, to verify that the email's domain is configured to receive mail, which none of the previous methods were able to do. Inside the function, we create a result variable where we store the result of the validate email function for the email with the deliverability check enabled. If this check doesn't result in an error, we can simply return true as I did here. If it's not true, it raises an error via the email not valid error class we use later on. I use this approach to show you how you can access the additional information the check provides. Therefore, we say, if return details is true, which we can set in the input, then we can use the result variable to access the valid status, the normalized email, the local part of the email, the domain part of the email, and the domain info field that typically contains the domain's mail exchanger, MX records, indicating its configured mail servers. To get more information about this, please see the link in the description below about the package. To complete this function, we add two error handlers. The first one is the already mentioned email not valid error, which we get when the check above is not true, and return, for example, that the email is invalid, and additionally the error message explaining why. The second is a general exception if we encounter additional non-validation related issues. Here we can also say, if the return details is not empty, we can use this information for further debugging in the error handling. And that's it. As I run this code, we see I used a bad naming convention for my file, and it raised an import error because my file is named the same as the library I want to use here. Let's fix this quickly. Therefore, I have to rename the file, which I do here to 4emailvalidator.py, and rerun. This is now the best and most accurate output because all edge cases are handled well, and we identified all valid and invalid emails. Awesome! If you don't want to use a DNS lookup to perform a less strict validation, just set it to false as I did here. If you do so, we see the first email is also valid now because it failed previously on the DNS lookup. And that's it. This is all I wanted to show you in this video. I hope this video helps you. If you enjoyed this video, please consider giving it a like and subscribe. On the left is first a video YouTube thinks you should watch, and then my latest one I suggest to you. Happy coding! I'll see you in the next one.